Welcome to our worship service for the 15th Sunday after Pentecost. We're very happy that you have chosen to worship with us today. Let us pray. O God, because without you we are not able to please you, mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Reading from the letter to the Romans. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own God that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God. While those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each of us will be accountable to God. The word of the Lord.
Sure. A reading from the Gospel according to Matthew. Peter came and said to Jesus, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? About seven times?" Jesus said to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and he could not pay. So the Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and his children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell down upon his knees before him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, 'Pay what you owe.' Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will repay you.' But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he could repay his debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, 'You wicked slave, I forgave you all the debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?' And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until his debt could be repaid. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister with your heart." The word of the Lord.
Today, our reading from Matthew asks us to consider forgiveness. Forgiveness is at the heart of the gospel. Forgiveness is at the heart of the Lord's Prayer. And forgiveness is really, really hard spiritual work. I'm told that there are records of church councils in 16th century Switzerland dealing with the issue of a parishioner who refused to say the Lord's Prayer. He said he couldn't say the Lord's Prayer because he knew that if he did, he would be obliged to forgive the merchant who he believed had cheated him, and he wasn't about to be ready to forgive this man's offence to him. Our reading from Matthew puts forgiveness front and centre, and not just forgiveness of the kind that leads to reconciliation, but forgiveness of those who believe they neither need our forgiveness nor who appear to want it. Forgiveness is tricky. More often than not, it takes time. It takes time because every one of us is a work in process. On any given day, our forgiveness is likely to be incomplete in some way. This is what Jesus talks about with Peter. When he says, in a process for the church, he says, if someone offends you in the church, you go to them individually. If that doesn't work, you take some elders. If that doesn't work, you go to the whole church. If that doesn't work, eventually you just simply have to let it go. Peter wants to know, good grief, how many times must I forgive on this basis? And Jesus says, not seven times, but 77 times. You must forgive. Well, why? Why is forgiveness so important when there is no reasonable and holy hope for reconciliation in this world or in our lifetime? And the answer has something to do with power. 2 weeks ago, we heard Jesus give Peter the keys to the kingdom. And he said, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. When we do not forgive, we are in some profound sense bound. We are less than free. We are in the thrall of another person or power who is taking up space in our hearts and in our heads and in our imaginations. Have you ever had a personal enemy? Someone out to get you, someone to destroy your life or your livelihood or your marriage, someone who is after your job and starts a whispering campaign in the office? If so, then you know what it is to be in the thrall of another person. Have you ever been put in the position of being a scapegoat, taking the blame for some wrong you did not commit? Then you know what it's like to be in the thrall of another person. Have you ever been humiliated, perhaps, or robbed, or abused, or raped? Well, if you've thought about any of those things, then you've thought about revenge. And if you've thought about revenge, however sweet it is to imagine, then you know what it is to be in the thrall of another person. Because in a sense, when we're in the thrall of another, we're giving the person who violated us, or who abused us, or humiliated us, or wronged us in some way, we're giving them space in our person and the power to go on hurting us. Sisters and brothers, when we give another person power over our thoughts, our imaginations, our life in such ways, then we are not free. And we simply must figure out how to forgive. Or at least pray that we might find ourselves wanting to forgive. That Swiss Christian who'd been wronged by the tradesman wasn't even at that point yet. Now we know when we've been hurt. And we know how easy it is, if we're not alert to what is going on in our heart or our spirit, we know how easy it is to find ourselves nurturing grievance and allowing stony, hard lumps of hatred to grow in us. It's a process that bypasses intellect, it bypasses reason. We're all living in an age where politics of resentment and anger and fear make for a potent mix. And it's so easy to get caught up in the swirling eddies all about us. I limit myself to reading the news, not watching it. We don't have cable at home, which makes that discipline a little easier. But I can still feel my bile rising when someone says or does something of which I don't approve. And this is a human reality rather than a partisan reality. None of us is exempt from the need to tend to our souls. The cycle of resentment, violence can get so bad that it seems stoppable only by a savior. Well, we have one. We have a savior who himself was forgiving others even as he was dying on the cross. And that savior says, forgive. Unbind yourselves from all that hurt and all that resentment. Unbind yourselves by grace from all those injuries, both deep and shallow. Lay down any hatred or rage you feel against another, however righteous you believe yourself to be. This is not easy, but you must do it if you are to be free to claim the promises of the gospel. And as if to underline his point, Jesus goes on to tell a parable of the cycle of violence that follows when we turn our backs on the reality and necessity of forgiveness, where the servant who is forgiven much offers no such grace and forgiveness to others. And so he ends up in prison. And it's a prison of his own design, a prison of his own making, the consequences of his own actions. This can sound like a hard word, but forgiveness does not mean pretending that things are other than they are. Forgiving another does not mean the other should avoid or escape the consequences of his or her actions. It just means that we give up the right to be judge and jury. Forgiveness is really about us in the end, and not the other. And at the heart of forgiveness is the extraordinary grace of that king who had pity on his servant and forgave all his debt. We are asked to forgive as we have been forgiven, as we have been released, unbound, freed for abundant life, life today and life forever. Forgiving another is rarely easy. It starts with wanting to forgive. It starts with wanting to be freed from being in the thrall of another. But however hard, it is a central way, perhaps the central way, of claiming the promises of the gospel and living the fullness of life that we are all promised, each and every one of us, life today, life forever. I offer this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us pray.
O God, the source of all wisdom, in a time in which so many seek deeper knowledge of your love for all people, we pray that you open our hearts and minds to your love, the source of all life. We pray for those who lead us in faith, that the word of God may dwell in their hearts, that they strengthen the bonds of affection which unite us in your church.
We pray for the leaders of the nations, especially for those with power and influence wherever there is bloody conflict, asking that you grant them the will to seek peace with justice for all whom you have made. We pray for the respect, forbearance, and cooperation to be manifest among those of differing opinions and beliefs, that we may know your peace in our lives, our cities, our nation, and throughout the world. Protect those who are called upon to serve in situations of violence and grant their leaders wisdom to care for all of those entrusted to their care.
We pray for our church and for all who worship with us this day, asking that you bless us with the will to serve one another as Christ has served us. Grant us grace to forgive wholeheartedly those who have wronged us, that we may know ourselves unbound and freed to claim the promises of your good news. We remember before you those who are unaware of your love for them. Open their ears to hear your voice and open their hearts to the knowledge of your love in Christ.
We pray for those bowed down with grief, fear, or sickness, remembering especially Harry Keenan, Armando Pineda, Penny Glass, Steve Bergen, and Bruce Barrow.
Linda Chandler, Andy Bachner, Diane Parsons, Judith Farr, and Catherine Ebert. May your living word bring comfort and healing to all those in need.
We give thanks for all those who have died in the faith of Christ, especially remembering Liz Avila, the Reverends John D. Lane and Robert F. B. Hunter, and James Willard Redmond. We rejoice with them and all your saints, trusting in the promise of your word fulfilled.
As we give thanks today for the birth of Nelson Jameson Bond, we celebrate all who care for children, especially those in our parish who lead our children's chapel. Accept, O Lord, the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and upon all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray in the words our Savior Christ has taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Almighty God, long-suffering and of great goodness,
we confess with our whole heart our neglect and forgetfulness of your commandments, our wrongdoing, thinking, and speaking, the hurt we have done to others, and the good we have left undone. Forgive us, for we have sinned against you. Renew a right spirit within us, and restore us to the joy of our salvation, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord will be always with you.
And also with you.
Following this recording, you will see an opportunity to make a financial offering to support the ministries and the life of our parish. Your generosity has been very, very important to the continued support of our ministries. We thank you very much for that. Also, you will be seeing a welcome card, digital welcome card, beneath this video in YouTube. If you are new, we will be very grateful to know from you and to accompany you in your journey of faith. Let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to the Lord.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.